Parental discretion is advised.
This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/wrestlingmayhemshow. It is the Wrestling Mayhem Show, where we get together and converge in one digital location to talk about professional wrestling. I'm Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on the Twitter here in Mayhem Studio in Pittsburgh, PA. We got a very special guest with us. But first, we're going to go to Poughkeepsie, New York, where the only Mayhemmer on the crew with a future endeavor letter from the WWE, he is Mad Mike.
Sorg, I am here. I am excited, not about SmackDown, but about my brand new Lucha Underground shirt.
Ooh, nice, nice.
Yeah, I'm excited because guess what, Sorg? Lucha Underground has a panel at New York Comic Con. Guess who's going to be there? This guy.
That's right. And guess who's 19 hours closer to having caught up on Lucha Underground? Started from episode one. And did a binge on there. Thank you, Mike, for helping me through the first four episodes of it. We got some watch party stuff that should be up in the coming weeks. And we'll be doing that again. I think as early as this weekend. I think this Sunday we're going to go through the rest of the 19 of the first. And we have to do something special for Ultima Lucha, hopefully on Sunday night. So keep an eye out for the link for that live stream if you guys want to join us.
The Lucha Party.
Yeah, also joining the Lucha Party is Bobby F. J-Town from Johnstown, PA.
Guys, I also have a panel, but it's in my room above me, my ceiling panel.
Right. Right.
Not quite as exciting.
No, not nearly as exciting. And with us in the studio, he was recently on Ring of Honor show here in Pittsburgh, PA, and then all the way to a riverfront view for a wrestling show this weekend that we were talking about before. He is Chris LeRusso back on the show.
Thank you for knocking me down a notch and making sure to mention that, you know, he was at Ring of Honor and then he wrestled in a state park.
He's everywhere. He's getting
all just, right. I see how it is.
I think it reflects your busy and varied schedule.
That's one way of putting it. Thank you very much for having me tonight.
And of course, he's going to be on House of Hardcore 20. That's going to be here in Pittsburgh, PA, taking on a friend of the show, Walking Weapon, Josh Alexander, for the Super Indie title.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. That was, I said it at Royal Valley that performance at Super Indie was one in a million. He had an absolutely amazing performance at Super Indie 15, but I think it's time to bring the Super Indie title back to the United States.
That's right. He's Canadian, for those that don't know. Awesome. And we'll be talking more about that, of course, throughout the show. This is your Wrestling Mayhem Show. You can join us here live at live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com every Tuesday at 10 p.m. Eastern, or listen to some very interesting stories we don't share on the live stream, but we do share that for our friends on Wrestling Mayhem Show Gold over at patreon.com/mayhemshow. And thank you to our friends that do support the show, including, of course, Bo Diggity.
Woo.
Woo.
Man, a little late on that. Okay. Hey, LeRusso gets it. He's with it.
I've been here for a minute. Yeah.
Yeah. He knows the deal. Also, thank you to
Is he technically a real co-host now, Sorg?
Oh, is this your third time on the show?
Yes. Yes. This would be the third time on the couch.
Oh, boom!
Yes.
Oh, you are officially a co-host of the Wrestling Mayhem Show now.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Welcome to the show.
It's been a long time coming, and I'll be taking steps to have you removed here shortly. So but then, you
that
know.
Means you get to read the rest of the Patreon people.
It's been tried
yeah.
before.
Oh, it's been tried. People have tried to muscle Zorg out.
There have been hostile takeovers.
Oh, geez.
Mm-hmm. Chachi did take over for an episode.
There was one time where several of the men of the Mayhem Show were tied up and duct taped.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to hear anything. Just stop there. We're good. So
hashtag varsity club.
Safe search, Rick Steiner.
And that's why you have to get on gold.
All right. So now you have to read the rest of the Patreons. Over
okay.
Here.
For everyone who's giving their hard earned money to make sure that Sorg can run out of something better than a shack, we have the Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast. What is that?
Betterment.
Betterment. Excuse me. The camera's in the way. Next. Edward J. Fiasco.
Edward J. Fiasco.
Edward J. Pronounce that. Burke is the second word name. Next. Alex Cards? Cars.
Yes.
Okay, got that one.
Bobby Snyder? Cars for Kids.
That's me.
Next.
That's it.
That's it. That's it. You all paid only a buck? What a bunch of cheapskates.
Yeah.
I'm gonna what are the levels of Patreon, Sorg? What are the levels of Patreon?
Well, it's whatever you want. It's a dollar and you get the gold. It's okay, it's the $5 and we've sent you business cards, you're an executive producer.
I'll tell you what, I'm gonna become a Patreon, and there's going to be a new segment on the show, the Chris LeRusso segment every week, and you'll just explain what I'm doing, even if I'm not booked. Chris LeRusso will be seen at a bar in Bloomfield drinking his face off this Saturday.
Okay.
That's
a new level. That's a new level, but okay. All right.
Buy a segment on the show.
Well, we actually do have that at the $50 level.
Buy a segment?
Yeah, we do, actually.
Yeah, as soon as you donate to Patreon, we will introduce or plug whatever you want. So if you want us to say that Chris LeRusso is like drowning his sorrows while suffering through Impact, you know, we can do that. It's fine.
You know what? I think I have a new charity that I will be patronizing here.
If you want to like send us your where Chris LeRusso is booked this weekend every week at a Patreon level. Yeah, we could do that. We should just put that for indie wrestlers. Like, indie wrestlers have money to give it to a podcast.
We do.
Yeah. Sure.
We send you to a different location every week with a striped shirt on, a striped hat, and glasses. Where's LeRusso?
Took me a second. I got it now. Thank you.
Or a Waldo reference, but I'm okay with either. Yeah. Waldo.
So that's one way you can support the show, patreon.com/WrestlingMayhemShow. But if you don't want to do that, just please share the show. Share the mayhem. There's plenty of stuff going on. And, of course, WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to the show on Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeartRadio, or YouTube and Facebook and other things. Oh yeah, drop us a line 412-206-WMS0 or that email address.
Good times
at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. All right, let's get into the show. First of all, Clash of Champions, or the first Raw pay-per-view. By the way, there's another one in like two Saturdays. Are you prepared? Two Sundays, I'm sorry.
There's so many pay-per-views. Sork.
So many 19 pay-per-views.
Now? Is that accurate?
19. I believe they're up to seven new ones. We're not on the schedule, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they count Clash of Champions because
I would assume it's a. I guess it's a new. Well, it's the same concept, new name.
Yeah, a little bit. I thought great show. I guess I'm tempering my expectations for these shows. Because we are getting them so often. And as it is, we just had a rematch of Dean and AJ tonight for the title. Mm-hmm. For the title. And
that wasn't a Clash of Champions, though. That was a Backlash. Is that correct?
That was a Backlash. Okay. But still, I think the concept poll is true. We had a rematch for Rusev and Roman Reigns the next night. I don't think these pay-per-views aren't being offered as pay-per-views anymore, right?
Like, yeah, they are.
They are?
Some of them.
Some of them are. So,
I think they both were, weren't they?
Maybe it depends from carrier to carrier, because I think a couple of them may have dropped WWE because of this development, right? But because especially since Clash of Champions definitely ran over the 11 o'clock mark. I don't know if they're actually putting in that extra half hour as a just in case. It feels like they're doing that just because they're on network and they can do whatever pretty much that they want. I think it makes sense, of course, that they would have WrestleMania and SummerSlam, Royal Rumble, Survivor Series. You know, maybe they'll keep the big four for any of those other pay-per-view outlets. But still, we kind of expect this. If they have this many pay-per-views, they're not going to be, I guess, resolution-wise. Not as clear, right? It gets you to the next night on Raw. And
there's been no resolutions in any of the pay-per-views.
Is that too? Just keeps you going.
No Year's Revolution. That's the new one for January.
No Year's Resolution.
That's the new one. That's the Raw pay-per-view.
But
in
still,
January.
In the meantime,
but they
already
have no MLC.
In the meantime, there's a certain Pepit on the internet that makes a really good point. These pay-per-views have been great, that they are giving a lot of these matches time, and we are getting really good matches out of it. Even Sheamus and Cesaro, that, you know, maybe some of us have kind of yawned at over the last few weeks, I thought was great.
But there is no finish.
Exactly.
But
you see what they did with it, right? Which congratulations.
That's not a good thing for either of those guys. We just did the League of Nations. It didn't work.
I would argue that the whole point of that series, and there were a lot of people who had very strong opinions about how that match ended. The whole point was to, one of these guys is getting a title shot. One of these guys is going to the next level. One of these guys, and I kind of felt like that was the underlying, if it was never explicitly said, it was definitely implied throughout the course of that. And then for it to end with a non-finish, and then to go a completely different direction, because it appears, at least as of right now, that neither Sheamus nor Cesaro are going to be moving into Universal title,
the world
picture.
Title feud where they could both have awesome matches with Kevin Owens.
Yeah, it does not appear like that's the direction that they're going. Which, as much as it would be good to pump up the tag team division, I don't know that this, is this the best use of both of their talents? Is what sounds like is the argument from a lot of people. So
yeah, and the thing is, unless they beat New Day, which I don't think they're going to, because I think at this point they're just going to have New Day hold it until they beat Demolition Dream for whatever reason. In the process of doing that, they're destroying any other tag team that they have. Because the Club, I don't take seriously anymore. They might as well be Rowan and Harper. Like, seriously.
They still take them seriously, but yeah, they just didn't win.
I mean, I love the New Day. I do. But this super long tag title reign is killing the rest of the division. If you still had all the teams, like if there was only one tag title between WWE as a whole, you can keep that going. That's no problem because they're only facing one tag team per show, per pay-per-view. But they've beaten the Shining Stars. They've beaten Enzo and Cass. They've beaten the Club numerous times. Unless this Cesaro Sheamus team is the one that beats New Day, it devalues the whole. And if that is the case, if Cesaro and Sheamus are beating the New Day, what does that say for the rest of your established tag teams that two random mid-carders they threw together can beat the 400-day reigning champions?
Yeah, but they're the best mid-carders we got.
No, they're not.
Hey, Sheamus and Cesaro, though.
Rusev.
Yeah.
I present Rusev. I mean,
it's a common storyline to do the tag partners who hate each other. And that despite their personal animosity, their combined talents and, chemistry makes them a greater team than they ever could have realized. So I understand the harkening back to, teams like Benoit and Kurt Angle, they were at each other's throats, but as a team, they were unstoppable. Again, it's just, it's interesting to go this far left, especially because, like I said, the entire time through that 7-match series, I was thinking, okay, Cesaro is going to get to the, is going to get the big, big push at the end,
which is a little bit of a stutter step for that, again, Cesaro trying to prove that he's worthwhile, right? Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Mike, you're saying that this is kind of worthless unless they kind of beat New Day, but still, it needs to be. Man, I hope we get a lot more out of this than just them beating up jobbers until that happens. In the meantime,
as a quick aside, can you go to Cesaro's Twitter? He put out a tweet today that literally had me laughing out loud.
Okay.
For those of you who saw the pay per view, I think Bobby knows what I'm talking about.
I know which one, yeah.
Working on it.
So, okay.
Also, Daniel Bryan contacted him, too.
Oh, yes.
That would be the best idea.
Is it the meme?
Yes, it is the meme.
Is the meme here? Please explain this for our audio listeners.
What it is it is the Simpsons, and it is Ralph Wiggum going headfirst through a window, and the meme says, Cesaro be like. And for those of you who did not see the pay-per-view, Cesaro took one of the most terrifying Superman planches that I have ever seen. And I've been around wrestling now. I've been a fan my entire life. I've been in the business for 12 years. That is the most terrifying dive I've ever seen.
No more topes.
Yeah.
yeah.
Going back to the tag team thing, though, Lucha Underground has done this before.
But see, the thing is, in Lucha Underground, literally anyone can be a tag team because Dario Cueto's a dick.
Well, Mick Foley chose to be.
Mick Foley is not a dick.
Yeah, but Mick Foley took it as these two guys push each other to the limit. Let's see what they can do together, not fighting each other anymore.
Okay, but if that was his whole idea, just team them in the first place.
No, that wasn't his whole idea.
This was the first place from the get-go.
Listen to his promo, Mike. He says, I love you guys to fight again, but I don't want you to kill each other because you're just going to keep going. Therefore, I'm going to put you together. Because you're both badass. That was
a spot on decision right there.
Yeah. Or you could give them both each individual title shots because they're badass. Putting them in the tag division doesn't help either of them. They've both been there.
What needs many to happen? Times. Here's what needs to happen. What needs to happen is because obviously Gallows and Anderson, should be done with the New Day after losing like two in a row for reals. I want to see Gallows and Anderson have a knockout dragout brawl with those two. I think if that happens I think that would make sense. Right?
I think Gallows
it'd be way better if it was for the titles.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to be for the titles away. You got to build these guys. Yeah. These guys can't just be thrown into a title shot. I think you ruin it if they just get thrown into a title shot.
They are getting a title shot. That's the point.
Oh, they are. That's right. They are.
Yeah, that's the point, Zorg.
But didn't it say down the line?
No, next week.
Oh, Staples Center.
Next week, Staples Center. They're getting a title shot.
Oh,
maybe it's gonna be.
This
Ashton
is my
Cooper
point.
And the other guy.
This is my point exactly.
Okay. But then they have to live. Then they have to feud with Gallows and Anderson and have a knockout dragout. Like that has to happen at some point during this. All right, Mike's frustrations aside, other things did happen on the Clash of Champions. Yeah, they did. We had great matches. We had good stuff.
Yeah, I'm not saying we didn't have great matches, but did anything really happen?
We had great matches. We had great matches. We had a Cruiserweight division debut. TJ Perkins debuting on a pay-per-view.
Yeah, with an awesome theme song and everything.
Yes.
Almost the closest you can get to a Mega Man song.
To the point where the official Mega Man Twitter account congratulated on his ring entrance in music. That's amazing.
He should come out to the dog. He should come out to the ring with a dog now.
Yeah, just the dog skateboard.
Oh, he should use the old Sin Cara trampoline and just disguise it as Rush.
Nice.
Reference for those of us who played Mega Man on the NES. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Sorry, kids. Sorry. I thought it was fantastic, and I want to talk a little bit about the Cruiserweight division a little later in the show in general. But I am amazed. This is what I got out of that whole thing. We changed the ring ropes for every Cruiserweight match.
Yeah. How?
No, I want to say how. I mean, and I don't know why it definitely astonishes me because I've watched ring ropes and indie shows going up and how. Like it seems like it takes
how it takes
for
4 days to normally get ring ropes up. Yeah. Yes,
you know how that is.
Yes, I'm very much aware.
So I mean,
God help us if one of them breaks. I mean, like
it's half a show right there,
yeah,
right?
I mean,
thanks, Wardlow.
Your match will come on tomorrow. That there was an amazing picture for those at the first Royal Valley show. Mm-hmm. Wardlow does the Brock Lesnar up and tears the top rope right off the ring. Well, now great.
Which was the best one because it was I think it was like a six man or an eight man involving the sexy talented dudes.
It was Wardlow and the STDs versus Palace, Bulk, Remy, and yeah, it was an eight man and yeah. Santana and the debuting at that time Santana Diamond.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Yeah.
But anyways, so to think on Monday Night Raw, they did it twice. They did it for both cruiserweight matches, and this shouldn't be much to it. Obviously, like maybe Steph had to dress down Mick Foley for a couple minutes longer than usual in order to buy time for this. Maybe we had an extra Mr. Robot commercial to
purple tape.
The purple tape.
Rapid.
No, I don't think they taped. I don't think they retaped the ropes every
that
time.
Would be impressive.
That would be impressive. Yeah. But I mean, we've all been to live Raws, right? We've seen them just like change everything.
But
all the ring
apron.
They've taken
apart the stage for like weddings and stuff like that, and it doesn't take long for them.
No. So I'm sure that's down to a science, right? I can't wait for my next live Raw in town. I know we're getting a SmackDown pay per view here. In December.
Yeah, so I was about to say December, correct?
Yeah, well, but it's a SmackDown pay-per-view, so you're not going to see that. Unless the women's division suddenly gets pink ropes every
match. Oh, man, Alexa Bliss is coming.
Get in your car, Bobby.
There we go. Bobby needs car
bits. I'm going
to that one. They were in Wheeling, West Virginia last night for a house show, actually. Mm-hmm. Got some pictures from Matthew and Jennifer Carlin's Foundation for Podcast Betterment on the Wrestling Mayhem Show Facebook, actually, of that. But no, that is dedication to that they're bringing over that color scheme and branding, you know. I think is really impressive, and hopefully it's like not a thing that fades. Mm-hmm. Like I always worry about, hey, we got this new thing, and it just kind of fades off in the background. Thankfully, the women's division has not done that yet, right?
Mm-hmm. I don't think it will because I mean it costs them zero money to do that.
Yeah,
like it. It wouldn't it's not like where you have like the Sin Cara lighting effect during a match or something like that. Like
that was the thing I was going to bring up. Like they didn't stop doing that for a while.
Oh and no! But there's a little more behind this, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's even to the point where I didn't realize Drew Gulak was on last night, and then there was an article.
I also wonder if they're like different ropes.
What?
No, like different ropes, like geared more toward cruiserweight usage.
You mean tighter ropes?
Yeah.
I hadn't even considered that.
Yeah, like I mean, it would make sense that you know, because if I mean, it's probably not. WWE is usually pretty uniform with everything, but I wouldn't put it past them.
I know they have a crash ring at the Performance Center, and I think you've seen that in some of the highlight reels where ring is specifically designed to practice high-flying maneuvers so that the canvas isn't as stiff. So I don't think it's out of the realm of possibilities that there were ropes specifically for the high flyers.
Well, okay, you're the only one here that has experience with this. I mean, how much of a difference? I mean, you've been in all kinds of rings.
A huge difference.
Yeah.
A huge difference. I mean, there are ropes that and IWCs are pretty good. Mm-hmm. But I mean, there are rings that if you try and springboard, you're putting your life, you know, at risk.
Right.
Because they sag so much, or that the wrapping around the rope is so loose that the minute you put your feet on it, they'll just roll right off, and so you can't get your footing or get your balance at all. There's other ones that might as well be like walking a tightrope cable. They're just so that don't move at all, and running those ropes is a lot harder. But it makes springboarding and, you know, getting to the top. And I don't even springboard that much. But I know that there have been times when I would like to have done it. And then I check the ropes like, well, not doing that tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And so it could make a difference. You know? But I really don't know. And you know, somebody who's been there and around there would probably know far better than I. So
it does make me wonder if this is the kind of thing where maybe that does slide into being that first hour thing. Like maybe this is some of that experimentation. Like it harkens me back to the failed experiment where they said, hey, we're gonna have WCW in the middle of Raw. The one fateful match with Buff Bagwell and Booker T and what the heck is his name? Was his name also Hank Hudson? Something Hudson?
Scott Hudson.
Thank you. Because like Hank Hudson is the ring announcer here locally.
Yeah, Scott Hudson put together Bunk's Adventure.
What?
That's a reference.
Okay, sure.
Never mind.
But it feels like that, where they're like, we're trying to brand within the brand, so maybe that brand becomes its own thing, right? And obviously CWC is kind of that thing where we did this over here and built this thing up, and now we're bringing it into Raw, right? We're absorbing it into Raw, but keeping that brand in there, you know? It feels like the old, like, hey, all the lights turn into WCW, and here we are, right? And maybe that's part of the experiment, to see how it flies on the main stage before maybe they say, hey, that first hour is Cruiserweights, or something like that. And I talked about it last night on the wrap up, like, it feels like, and I think across both brands, like, the divisions feel distinctive now, right? The women's division, there's lines of things happening that aren't just the secondary third thing to what's going on at the title. Like, it's just, we're popping up. Hey, there's a storyline here. There's a direction here. There's a direction here for each title, not just who's next. Mm-hmm. Right. Not just, hey, who goes for the title next, and that's all we're worried about. There's secondary things with the women. There's secondary things with the tag titles, or with the tag divisions.
What's
right?
with the SmackDown tag titles? I'd argue that's not the same for Raw.
Well, I think for Raw a little bit. I thought maybe that the Sheamus Cesaro thing kind of turned into the secondary thing for us.
Also,
we have Enzo and Cass doing stuff. Like, Enzo and Cass have this interesting side feud going on with Owens and Jericho. Right? So, like, it is an ongoing feud. No, it's not something that leads to pay-per-view matches or anything, but it's something that we can randomly have a main event on Raw that kind of makes sense, because they were feuding before the Universal title was even involved.
People's trying
to... Cass was in the match for the Universal title.
Of course.
And so, I think McMahon's very high on Cass, mm-hmm. and would like to see him one day.
So keeping him nearby kind of makes
sense.
He's
confusing him with Kevin Nash.
Just look at him.
He's like, oh, did Nash and Test have a baby? Is that what happened here?
That's look like it. And somehow he's from Brooklyn.
You notice they've never stood Big Cass next to Stephanie for those comparisons. They've never done it.
Hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I want to watch out for that.
There's a wedding in the works, Sork.
No.
She's married. She's a married lady.
She was married the first time too, Bobby.
Side note, by the way, the whole oh no, Stephanie got in a limo last night with her husband.
Oh God, it's so bad.
What? I'm very suspicious of you getting a ride with your husband at the pay per view last night. It's like she's right. It's my husband, you know. But anyways, I digress.
Then again, he did roofie her and take her to a chapel to get married.
Please let's not go. Let's not. Please stop pulling on that string.
Speaking of questionable wrestling storylines,
we talked about
a lot of questionable wrestling things that happened during Wrestling Mayhem Show Gold. So
first and last bachelorette party ever on WWE.
Wait, the test one?
The Stephanie one. Because that happened after Stephanie's bachelorette party.
Oh, okay. Okay.
We don't even have the excuse of saying it was the 80s. We didn't know better.
You never get the...
Nope.
Yeah,
nope.
It was 2000. It was the aughts.
No.
We didn't know better.
It was like...
Jesus.
So
99?
98, 99.
Okay. I mean, you know, the 90s.
I mean, great. Stephanie's bachelorette party wasn't exactly the most...
happened in the roaring 20s.
Here's the thing.
She just had May and Moolah there.
You never...
Happened in the roaring 20s. It was about villains, I tell ya.
You never see the intro. All you ever see is the wedding, the chapel wedding. Mm-hmm. Whenever they do the flashbacks all over the place, so you forget about that part. You need to go back and watch that episode because you know, classic.
Good Lord.
Oh boy. Actually, what they probably showed it the week before or something, right? But
no. They showed the bachelor.
They came back. He said, "Oh, this is what really happened after the party," or something like that, right?
Yeah, because Triple H paid the limo driver to roofie Stephanie.
Man, that's
next topic.
All right. So hey, we'll talk a little bit more about. I forget. Oh. There's a certain promotion that might be in trouble. As if we, if you're surprised.
Ding dong, the witch is dead. Witch, oh, witch, the wicked witch. Ding dong, the wicked witch is dead.
Mad Mike, I just want you to be aware of something. Jason Voorhees looked down for the count many, 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 many times.
All right, well, that's your teaser. That's your teaser.
He got to space where TNA never
went. Sorg, do we have enough Patreon money to finish the after this segment tonight?
What?
Sorg, do we have enough Patreon money to put on Bound for Glory is what he's asking.
Yeah.
Sorg, you know. I think we can do this. We'll get some GoPros. I'll mega bus down to Florida. It'll be great.
You know, can we reach the big question?
The consortium was me.
I got the reference. I got the reference. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll get to that in a moment. But in the meantime, you can maybe help us buy TNA by
can we start a GoFundMe page?
Checking out our friends at IndieWrestling.us, where a lot of people that are on the show.
Great segue.
We're going to start an Indiegogo to find TNA.
Now, see, the wrestling Kickstarter should really, it should be called Super Kickstarter, right?
Super,
not Indiegogo, Super Kickstarter.
Super Indiegogo?
Super Kickstarter.
Anyways, IndieWrestling.us, please change the topic. We're such people featured, like we were talking about Cesaro, the very European, the travels of Claudio Castagnoli and IWC, or check out Rumble in Royal Valley, including, hey, look, there's a familiar face on there, Chris LeRusso, in a fantastic three-way dance with Jason Corey and Alex Daniels there, and in a very hellacious fans bring the weapon street fight between Remy LeVay, Keith Haught, friends of our show, and Marshall Gambino and Bronco McBride. Go check it out. Rumble in Royal Valley. It's up there on digital download and DVD. DVD is actually shipping in the morning for all you pre-orders out there that hooked us up at the show. So much more, including Renegade Wrestling Alliance, some Prime Wrestling, Best of Prime Wrestling, including I know he just had the his last show at AIW. His big send-off, Johnny Gargano. A lot of titles on there. Best of him. Two volumes in Prime Wrestling, where he came up in Cleveland as well, and so much more. IndieWrestling.us, sign up for the newsletter, get a free show, including AJ Styles on that show at the IWC 100th show under Norm Connors back in, I think it was 2008, perhaps? So go check it out. And other fun stuff for Wrestling Mayhem Show. Keep updated, keep up new releases, and more. IndieWrestling.us. Okay, so I threw this in here because I saw, obviously there's been a little bit of talk about buyers and everything. I think we discussed a little bit late show last week. But I saw a headline that TNA may not have enough money for the next Impact or Bound for Glory. Like the next Impact as in this week's Impact may not air?
Well, no. This one on air is already in the can.
Okay.
It's already in the can. But they may not have money for Bound for Glory, which is Sunday. Or any of the, then this is what they said last week. There are 6 Impact tapings scheduled for after Bound for Glory. 6.
Okay.
That's probably enough Impact to get us to Thanksgiving, Sorg.
Ooh, that, yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh.
Like, this feels like that weird spot where they were kind of, I think, for the on their way out of Spike TV. And there was a bunch of stuff in the can, and they weren't even sure if they'd be around on January 1st, basically.
You mean the episodes that aired on Spike TV at 1 and 2 in the morning, where they pushed a Mahabali, Shira, TJ Perkins, possibly homosexual storyline? Yes, that's exactly the time.
Whoa! Okay, yeah. Okay, so it was the best of time.
There's a reason we didn't review those, Sorg.
Okay, all right, I got you.
They should get John Taffer to do Bar Rescue with TNA.
Who the real loser in all this is if Bound for Glory doesn't get put on? Gail Kim, because she's never going to get inducted in the Hall of Fame.
No. I feel really, really bad for Cody Rhodes.
Oh, I don't feel bad for Cody Rhodes.
I don't feel bad for Cody. There are so many places that are planning to make use of Cody Rhodes' talent. Mm-hmm. He is not going to hurt for work.
WWE just buys TNA outright. And they're like, welcome back.
You know, as much as, you know, there's the easy jokes to be made, and a lot is that there's the, you know, that this company has, you know, been on life support or come back from the dead so many times. You know, it is something to consider that any grievances you may have with creative or with management, there's a lot of really, really, really talented people who, you know, yeah. I feel
no question.
I feel terrible for that. Yeah. And even if TNA continues, just to be in that environment where it's a question, are we going to have a pay-per-view this weekend? That sucks. And that sucks for those guys who've been busting their ass. I'm sorry,
say that again. Yeah, because they all have to travel down there too.
Yeah, and you can say whatever you want again about management, creative, you know, anything like that. You cannot deny that the people bell to bell have been doing everything that they possibly can to try and keep this to put on the best wrestling show they possibly could. Matt Hardy has completely reinvented himself. And for a long time there was the talk of the wrestling world. And just doing like working so hard to try and to right the ship. And it's just, it sucks to see that, you know, people, friends of mine, people who I've worked with and people who I respect a great deal and who I admire, you know, are put in this situation. Again, I'm not ready to throw flowers on the grave of TNA just yet. This company has had so many times where people are like, this is it, this is it, this is it. And somehow they always manage to come out, you know, from the previous segment, Jason Voorhees always seems to come back from the dead. But, you know.
Yeah, but in progressively worse movies usually.
And to be fair, they don't hold pay-per-views on Friday the 13th.
TNA is going to space.
It's just, I, you know, I feel for the people who are down there, and I hope for their sake more than anything else, I hope that TNA gets gets reprieve from the governor.
Honestly, though, like, I love a lot of the talent down there, but I think TNA going under might help them, because most reports are that they don't get paid on time. They're not allowed to do indie booking dates where it's televised or it's going on DVD or stuff like that.
This may actually free a lot of them up. That has been loosened a bit, I can tell you.
Yeah, because of necessity, because they can't pay people.
Yeah, I mean, it was a big problem.
If TNA doesn't exist, you can actually get Ethan Carter going all around the world and being super successful.
But in the meantime,
you can get Mike Bennett going back to Ring of Honor and trying to take over the kingdom again. Like,
yeah.
You could have a lot of things.
Right, right. And these guys are getting around a little bit. Ethan Carter is even on House of Hardcore. It's coming
Ethan
here. Carter's
going to be on House of Hardcore. So, I think Pepper Parks. I know him as Pepper Parks. What's Braxton his name?
Sutter.
Thank you. I'm sorry.
Oh, is Pepper Parks on TNA?
I believe he's on House of Hardcore.
Okay.
So if I, let me make sure, before I start telling tall tales.
I thought I saw him on the poster.
He's on the poster.
Yeah.
So,
and also the former Bull Dempsey's on there too.
Former Bull Dempsey, Swoggle, EC3. Yeah, there's a, I mean.
Oh, yeah, and apparently a lot of B. Arthur's, according to our city's rendition.
That was funny.
That was great.
That was really funny.
That was great. Best tweet, the tweet of the week when I saw Tommy Dreamer tweet that out. Anyways. No, I'm with you. And maybe that is a thing where these guys get released from their contracts and the other promotions kind of clean up, you know?
But if you don't think NXT is going to look at least half the TNA roster.
Right.
I mean, they already are. They got Rude. They got Aries.
You could book half of the next CWC with their X division.
Yep.
But, I mean, you're always
I'm going to say it. Zema Ion's ready to be on Raw right now.
Much as I completely agree with that statement, you always run the risk of if TNA does go under, are some people going to be able to make the jump to NXT? Yes. Are some people going to be able to make the jump to Lucha Underground? Yes. But there's going to be some people who won't. to Ring of Honor, to New Japan, to England, to, you know, yes, there will be, the cream will always rise to the top, and there will always be, you know, some talent that can survive, but there are going to be people who don't, and that always, you know, because no place can take them all.
Right. Right. Yeah, yeah, and they're kind of going to be scattered to the wind in this case.
I can't wait to see Abyss as the fifth Wyatt member in the Pittsburgh SmackDown pay-per-view.
I mean, you know, you've heard rumors that WWE wants Matt Hardy back because they want to do the broken character. You know, I'm sure that, like you said, someone like DJZ, I mean, DJZ could easily be at the top of Lucha Underground or the top of NXT or go right to the Cruiserweight division on Raw. You know, I'm a big fan of his work and acknowledge that. Again, it's just you hate to see any situation where there's that uncertainty. And that's the big thing that we have as we're, like, it's not even that the pay-per-view is officially canceled. Mm-hmm. It's not even that the Impact tapings have been officially canceled. No one knows.
And I want to point out, because I'm following the breadcrumbs from what I saw here, and I don't see anything cited. Like there's no, like, this was heard from a good source or anything like that. Like, yeah, this is what's happening. So, I mean, reports like this are as strong as they usually are on wrestling websites. But it's looking more and more in this direction, and it's very possible. It'll be interesting. We'll know Sunday, right?
I mean, Sunday at the latest.
Like, what happens? What happens when the pay-per-view can't go on? You know, do we just get, you know, another airing from the Spice Channel, or what happens there? I don't know. I haven't had cable forever.
You kind of dated yourself with that reference there.
I'd love to buy it and order it, but if it doesn't go on, I know they're not giving me my money back.
The cable company should.
Sunny's porn. Holy shit.
Oh, thanks, Bobby. We know the finish to that, Bobby.
Definitely not clean finish.
Next segment.
Wow. Okay. Well, from there.
Speaking of that, do you guys like pizza?
I was going to say, we got to talk about something else to give me.
Go to commercial. Go to commercial.
The perfect piece of pepperoni pizza for Pittsburgh podcasting.
Go, Mad Mike. It's better than anything we could get at this point.
I was hoping to get a buffer story in there so we didn't go direct into the food sponsor.
We need a Mattress Firm commercial. Mattress Firm.
Leave off the last S.
Sorg, it's going down. Unless you're going to land this thing in the Hudson, get to the commercial.
You know, it's really funny because...
You know... We can't go from Sunny to Sully. We can't do that.
Guys, this just in, Billy Corgan has rescinded his offer to buy Mayhem Show.
what are we going to do for the rest of tonight, though, Bobby?
Hey, don't look at me. I'm just a rat in a cage.
Oh,
despite
no.
all my rage.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Guys, so, by the way,
that over there in that pizza box over to my right? What is that?
Hey, Slice on Broadway, a good friend's providing the perfect pepperoni pizza for Pittsburgh podcasting for a good while, feeding all the guests. And did you get a slice? It might be a little cold by now, but did you get a slice?
I'm good.
He's on a wrestling diet. I get it. Yeah. You know, that's all right. They have salads, too.
Nope.
They have salads, too. Just so you know. Slice on Broadway here in Pittsburgh. Mad Mike was here just a little bit ago. Bobby's got to get in a car and get in here, too. They have some slice. Bob, you've had slice. Really you've good. Had the slice. You're digging
Bobby,
it.
You should, Bobby, you should invite Alexa Bliss to go get slice.
Yes. Yes. Oh, you know, we have an N64 tournament coming up here in a couple weeks, and I'm hoping we have the opportunity. Maybe we'll get some slice for you guys. Are part of it. $10 entry fee, you know.
Do you think if I ask Alexa Bliss nicely, she'll go out on a date to Slice on Broadway with me?
I'm sure she's also on a diet, but they
give it a shot. What do you got to lose?
Yeah, you know, whatever. She'll be in town. She'll be in town for December. Be like, listen, Alexa Bliss, this is a wonderful pizza place. And I know you're only going to be able to have salads because you're very tiny and very fit, but they have free smells. I don't care if that's what somebody else says.
Sorg, Sork, I know it's been a while since you've been in the dating game. Do not promise a woman free smells.
Free smells.
Don't do no, that's not that Sork.
Man, that was how you did it in 1998.
The hell was
which was the last time I was
did it wrong then.
Which was the last time I was in the dating game.
I'm trying to remember what the hell I was doing in 1998.
How do you think we got wife of the show?
We were watching Stephanie and Tess get married.
Oh, good.
All of this while pizza is on the screen. And I'm getting hungrier. And if he isn't going to eat those slices, I am.
Be my guest.
Slice on Broadway, sliceonbroadway.com, PJH_slice on the Twitter. Please don't tell him about this commercial. Slice on Broadway on the Facebook and Instagram. Thank you so much to our friends out there.
I'll give one quick vote because I did have a slice on Broadway at PNC Park a couple weeks ago, and it was excellent pizza. My highest recommendations.
There you go. We'll be back with the big question after this. Let's talk tech. Tech news discussions from the people in the industry right here in Pittsburgh. Online, gadgets, startups, and more. Check it out at awesomecast.net.
Hey everyone, this is Showtime Eric Young from TNA, all nonstop wrestling on Spike TV. You're listening to the Wrestling Mayhem Radio Show.
Wrestling Mayhem Show. The crew's still here. Chris LeRusso, of course, with us. Going to be on House of Hardcore 20 here in Pittsburgh. Taking on Josh Alexander, the Walking Weapon. Are you intimidated taking on a guy named the Walking Weapon?
I wasn't until I saw Zorgatron Media's presentation of Super Indy 15, and you know, all kidding aside, what a performance! Mm-hmm. I mean, he was beyond impressive, and even though you know a lot of attention was paid to the match, the finals, and then the rematch with Jonathan Grisham. One of the most impressive things was the opening round match with Desmond Xavier, and especially the end of that match where he caught Dez out of a double back handspring right into the spinning pile driver. Incredibly, you know, amazing strength, and you know, Desmond Xavier is another guy who I think is absolutely fantastic. So, is that available on indiewrestling.us?
It's absolutely available on indiewrestling.us. Another plug. Also with us, of course, Mad Mike up in Poughkeepsie, New York, and Bobby of J-Town. Has interesting dreams about Rhino. Listen to Wrestling Mayhem Show Gold for that, if you haven't heard that before. So, it is time for the big question, and we have had a frequent caller who actually had a question I thought was worthy of the big question this week. And let's get into it.
Hey, guys. How you guys doing today?
Hi.
Hey.
Fine.
I just want to put out a question of possible talk on your Wrestling Mayhem Show coming up this week. And I just want to put this out there. Do you guys think AJ Styles is the best wrestler in the world? Because I was just looking at his all of his achievements on Wikipedia not too long ago. Thinking of it as a NWA heavyweight champion, TNA heavyweight champion, currently WWE heavyweight champion, and IWGP. What do you guys think? I was just curious and see what you guys wanted to say. But to me, based on my opinion, I think he is. So I just want to hear what you guys have to say. All right, guys. Catch you guys later, and I will listen to you guys on iHeartRadio. Bye.
I love the people listening to us on iHeartRadio.
Are you on iHeartRadio?
Yeah, we're on iHeartRadio. Oh, didn't you hear the intro? We say it every week.
See, Sorg, he is a real co-host because he doesn't listen to your intro anymore.
Oh, okay. I see. Yes, and doesn't listen back to the show. And okay, yep, pretty much. He's assimilated. So that is Daniel, our regular caller, Daniel, of course. So is AJ Styles the best wrestler in the world? Now I agree on paper. Yeah, I mean, he's definitely historically having, you know, all those championships under his belt. Certainly.
I mean, I don't necessarily know about that because there was one point where Big Show was the only person to ever hold the ECW, WWE, and WCW title.
Yeah, but it's kind of like that. That's kind of like the Daniel, or I'm sorry, the Dudley boy saying, "Well, we've held this and we've held the WCW title." Like, yeah, after they bought it, it was just the name, right? Like,
yeah, they weren't. But yeah, isn't saying AJ Styles is an NWA champion kind of the same
as TNA, NWA? Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah,
certainly,
because like,
certainly.
Because I mean, technically, Kurt Angle's an NWA champion.
And it's not that always bothered me in general when, because it's like, whoa, he was an NWA champion. That's completely the title that has the same lineage as Ric Flair and Dusty Rhodes and all those
George
guys.
George
Hackenschmidt and Bockwinkle, I'm sure had it right. Oh yeah, it's the one Shane Douglas threw in the trash can.
Yeah.
So, okay, other than that. So, obviously, if you go by the title thing, and I think it's a little, I mean, it's a great thing on paper, is, you know, in the context of wrestling, and that's something that they tout every week when they say, AJ Styles, look at all the stuff he's done. He's so important, right? And he's amazing, and greatest wrestler in the world. He is definitely up there.
It's interesting, because you were mentioning the titles, and I wanted to check, in addition to WWE champion, New Japan, blah, 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 blah. Some of his other accolades that I wasn't even aware of. 5-star match from The Observer, him, Samoa Joe, Christopher Daniels. The only 5-star wrestling match in TNA history, apparently.
Wow.
Outstanding Wrestler of the Year, 2014, 2015. Match of the Year, 2014. Wrestler of the Year, 2015. Ring of Honor Pure Champion. Ring of Honor World Tag Team Champion. Ring of Honor Pure Wrestling Tournament Champion, TNA Grand Slam Champion. How can you be a 2-time Grand Slam champion?
He won all 4 belts 2 times.
Oh. He's a 5-time Triple Crown Champion.
Yeah. Well, AJ Styles has the unique distinction of being a Triple Crown winner very, very early on his TNA career. Very early on TNA's career.
I believe still in the pay-per-view era, yeah.
A year. I think within like a year he was a Triple Crown champion.
I mean, from somebody who's had the opportunity to watch him live and see him in person, I remember at one point I think it was Remix Pro a year or two ago, he had an absolutely, forgive the cliche, phenomenal match with Facade. I mean, just tore the house down at Remix.
And I think around that time he had his incredible match with Matt Sydal.
Yes.
In Wheeling.
Yes, it was Sydal's first match back in the Independence. And again, tore the house down. Really, really incredible matches in Japan. Obviously, the one with Shinsuke Nakamura at Wrestle Kingdom stands out as, you know, one of the highlights of that show and one of the highlights of his. I think he was a 2-time New Japan champion when he went over there. Best wrestler in the world. You know what? I'm going to say yes, because he's somebody who, if I know there's going to be an AJ Styles match on, I have to watch it. I have to watch it sit down beginning to end. The match he had with Cena at SummerSlam was incredible. I thought the match with Ambrose was really good. I think it's going to be very interesting when he goes to the triple threat, because it's going to, for me personally, I can't think of anybody whose work I enjoy watching more right now. So I would say, yeah, AJ Styles, the best in the world.
He's kind of a cornerstone. Like, you know, you're going to get good stuff from him, and he's that guy on SmackDown that makes that, mm-hmm. like, it doesn't matter who you throw at him, it's going to be good, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I think that equivalent is, actually, maybe we have 2 of them now, but I was going to say Seth Rollins is that equivalent on Raw, if you look at mm-hmm. from that aspect, right? Because you're like, well, if they're having a match with Seth Rollins, yeah, this is going to be at least digestible, right? If you're looking at, you know, whatever you thought of Roman Reigns over the time or anything like that, right? AJ Styles had a tremendous match with Roman Reigns.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah.
So
two really good matches with Roman Reigns.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. So Yeah, I think that that argument can definitely be made.
One other quick thing, and then I'll open it up to the panel. I think another really big indicator was, do you remember the reaction he got at the Rumble? Like, that was maybe the loudest genuine reaction that I can remember in 5 years.
I think the location helped with that, though.
That did help a great deal, absolutely.
Where were they? Yeah, if that was, they were in Florida. That was in,
yeah.
They were in Orlando. I mean, they were in TNA's wheelhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everyone there knew who AJ Styles was. If they were in a non-wrestling town, like, not to pick on them, but Nashville.
No, I'd argue that, Nashville was the home of TNA before.
Well, yeah, okay, yeah, that's a fair point.
If they were somewhere in
Cheyenne, Wyoming.
Yeah, I was going to say somewhere in the Midwest or somewhere in, you know, somewhere that was not a TNA. Like, I think he would have gotten that kind of reaction in New York.
Oh, yeah. Well, everyone in New York knows who AJ Styles is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you went to New York, Philly, Chicago, you would have gotten the same reaction, if not louder. But if you go to, like, Sacramento,
mm-hmm.
to pick on a random Californian city that's not LA, like, not exactly a wrestling town, like, you know, TNA never ran shows there. So, I mean, but is AJ the best in the world right now? I watch Lucha Underground every week, and I don't know if I can say that.
Yeah. I feel like when you look at Lucha Underground, you're having different kinds of matches, though. Right? I want to call them spotty matches.
I'm not even talking like the spot fest.
I think if you look at that, like, Ring of Honor is more damning for that, if you're looking at it that way. But
I also think if you say best wrestler in the world, you got to look at Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of good wrestlers over in Japan, too.
I mean, Shinsuke.
Right now, currently.
Shinsuke.
Okada.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okada.
Yeah.
I think some arguments can be made about Kenny Omega.
Mm-hmm.
I think
I think I'd put AJ in my top five.
For sure.
I don't think I'd call him my favorite guy right now. I think that has to go to Kevin Owens.
Right. Right.
Because, like, AJ, great wrestler, phenomenal wrestler. Again, the puns. But and his promos are coming along. Like, he's probably one of the better promo guys on SmackDown. But the thing that has always been an issue with me with AJ Styles is his personality doesn't translate in the ring. Like the reason I enjoy Kevin Owens so much is Kevin Owens is constantly talking, like constantly giving his opponent shit during the match. Even someone like Nakamura is constantly playing mind games during the match.
Right.
Like, he's doing things. So you can be both a heel and a face when you do it. But, I don't know, AJ, like, you can tell he knows what he's doing in there. And you can tell he's extremely athletic, extremely gifted. But as far as, like, the persona doesn't carry into the ring. Once you see AJ in the ring, you know it's an AJ Styles match. But it doesn't really change that much whether he's a heel or a face.
Right. Okay, I got you. Versus like Kevin Owens, like, his match is an extension of his promo.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that.
Like I said, Kevin Owens should be mic'd up for every match he has.
He doesn't need to be.
No, and
he doesn't need to be with WWE cameras, but.
One of my favorite Kevin Owens things, I'm sorry to cut you off, but was when he was doing commentary after a match and he kept telling Byron Saxton to shut up. And just every time Byron said, shut up, Byron! And just would plow right over him.
Like, just a post-match beatdown of Roman Reigns, he screamed to Rusev, Machka something! Like, it's perfect! He is the most subversive wrestler, I want to say, in wrestling today. And it works on every conceivable... Because, like, he'll even throw out, like... He's the Cinema Sins of pro wrestling.
What's that?
He's the Cinema Sins of pro wrestling.
He's, like, the one who points out, this promo sucks. This segment is stupid. What are we doing here?
What are you going to do, Seth? This is where you come out and you expect me to fight you? No, that's not going to happen. I'm the champ. I'm not going to do that.
He also said, "Fade. I'm going to make you fade to black," and then he went, get it?
And even to the point where the stuff that he yelled at Roman Reigns there in their match a few weeks ago made it into the beginning of show promo about the match.
Didn't somebody say he also punched his vest?
Yes, and, yeah, like, I noticed that. He punched Roman Reigns in the SWAT vest and shook his hand because he's punching a fucking vest.
Amazing. Amazing. For as much as, and I know at the beginning, like, there's some people that we've had even on the show that are just like, I don't get it. He doesn't look like a wrestler. It's like, no, but everything else is there. It's like he's some kind of wrestling savant in promo and just put into a regular guy. Right.
Mm-hmm. And actually, you know who would probably be my number two right now? Since his career renaissance, I'm going to say Samoa Joe.
Mm-hmm.
Very good.
Fuck, is he doing good stuff
this,
on NXT?
This is the best. Hold on, Bobby. This is the best Samoa Joe since Kurt Angle.
Yep.
Like very easily. Like those were. Like I'm surprised when you say that. Was it the three way with
yes,
Joe and
AJ?
Yes,
it was Joe, AJ, and Christopher Daniels.
I'm surprised that none of the Samoa Joe Angle matches were 5 stars because they were so good, so good back then. Sorry, Bobby. Go ahead.
You know who I would also lump in to the conversation? Miz.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Oof, all around. If we're going
he's
all around.
Having a heck of a career comeback right now.
And those promos are out of this world.
Did you see the Knights?
Yeah.
Oh god. The
Knights
was amazing.
The one on Talking Smack was excellent.
The fact that he's punking out Brian by using Brian's moves in his matches. Oh, so good. So good.
Him and Ziggler right now are feud of the year so far, I think. It's close. It's up there.
We'll see how it ends.
Yeah, we'll see where that goes.
It's going to end one way or another in 2 weeks.
Yeah, we'll see how that goes. But
this would be, it would be so much better if this was over the world title. Because Ziggler doing all of this just for the Intercontinental title again.
Yeah, but that has a legacy.
But man,
is Dolph Ziggler.
But it's just for the Intercontinental title. Like, has the Intercontinental felt this important in ever?
Not for a long time.
Since Mr. Perfect.
No, sir.
When's the last time? Rose. Okay, wait, here's another question. When is the last time the Intercontinental title actually felt important to you?
Ric Flair.
Really?
Well, no. When Cody brought it back too.
Yeah.
Well, no, because remember, Ric Flair had the Intercontinental title, and that was when he was going on his retirement tour.
Not that long ago.
I remember the Intercontinental title. I mean, if I think highlights for the Intercontinental title, my mind goes all the way back to the Ultimate Warrior and Rick Rude and Mr. Perfect and like the
Razor Ramon HBK.
Razor Ramon,
maybe
HBK.
Maybe Brett and HBK.
Brett and Bulldog.
Triple H, Rock.
Yeah.
That was I'll go with you on that one. Yeah. But like those were the and you know what? Maybe I'll say that when The Rock had the Intercontinental title. May have been like before he truly fully ascended into being The Rock. That may have been the last time that I was like super, super, super into the Intercontinental title.
Because, I mean, I'm thinking just the 2000s. I'm thinking guys like Shelton Benjamin. Guys that were doing great matches, but it just felt like it was just passed around.
RVD was Intercontinental champion for a long time. RVD and Jericho.
RVD, Jericho. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were fine, but, you know, I feel like that era were as great as it was for the time. I mean, you know, we did have, like, was it China and Jeff Jarrett in a good housekeeping match for the IC championship, which led to her having it. And then there's the cohorting with Chris Jericho. That's where it felt a little, what are we doing here, guys? Mm-hmm. You know, I thought that was great
with Chris Jericho and China feuding over it.
But
Eddie Guerrero with the IC title was great.
Yeah.
Like, there have been some really great IC feuds. It's just, I've seen this before with Dolph Ziggler.
Right.
I want Dolph Ziggler to be important. I want him to be the focus of a show, and he's still always buried in the middle of the card. And I don't care if that's what he says in his promos.
Yeah,
Yeah. Just because you say it in your promos doesn't make it any less true.
I think it was the random fan I was talking to at Ring of Honor that was like, I love Dolph Ziggler, but I really wish he wasn't the Cleveland of pro wrestling.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Which he's from Cleveland.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. If yep. Dolph Ziggler is the Cleveland of pro wrestling, Miz is the LeBron.
Yeah. Yeah. Very much so. All right. Well, we have like two big questions now. the Intercontinental title, and of course, is AJ Styles the best in the world? Yeah, we need to do a Fave Five rundown at some point here.
Not today. I'll give you my Fave Five.
Meanwhile, I'll give you my Shucky Ducky of the night. Anyways, are you watching?
Sorg, you didn't answer the question. Would AJ be your fave?
Booker T.
My fave or the best in the world?
The best in the world.
I think he has every right if he wants to do a CM Punk style best in the world. Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. I mean, look at the guy. He left the Green Pastures of TNA where he dominated for so long, made a name for himself, and to the point where he could walk right into WWE and into a world heavyweight title in his
world champion within a year.
Yeah, world champion his rookie year. With WWE, when's the last time that's happened? Brock Lesnar?
It would have to be Brock, yeah.
And he was a
Sheamus.
Sheamus. Yeah, but yeah. We could still say that was kind of an accident. Tables.
Is that the foot through the table thing?
No, that is how it happened.
It does count. I know. But, yeah. but still, like it doesn't happen that often, right? There's a guy
also
that came
Kevin
in
Owens.
Like that. He went and proved himself as the best, got people's attention, and walked right in. Because I think he's a guy
like
that
Balor.
No matter how hard, yeah,
yeah, Finn Balor right there.
Finn Balor's
yeah,
another
like
one.
The night he debuted next week.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, not AJ didn't only do that in WWE. He also won the IWGP title his first night in New Japan.
And I would argue AJ Styles was not a guy that I ever thought was going to get a run in WWE because his promos aren't that cool. Great in the long run. He's got that southern accent and everything. I just figured he was a guy that I think that was what was keeping him from being signed by WWE, to be quite honest, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because you can't, he's still AJ Styles. He's still AJ, you know? And that he got to let his work, again, build that buzz that they couldn't ignore him anymore, basically, right? Mm-hmm. So I think that's the fact that he did that. And he's so good in the ring that whatever preconceptions about otherwise with him, that in the right time, of course, because we're seeing the changes in WWE in general, and that all came together. So, yeah, I'd say right now, yeah, absolutely.
And you guys know why this is all happening, though, right? The brand extension.
It is definitely assisting with it.
If the brand extension didn't happen, guess what? Roman Reigns would be our champion right now.
Hey, you know what? Also, I want to point this out with the brand extensions. No safe plays right now. No John Cena's. No Randy Orton's.
Well, let's wait two weeks.
Yeah, there's that. But
let's
still,
wait 2 weeks on that.
But still, the first 2-3 months of this, nowhere to be seen on the top. Mm-hmm. Nowhere to be seen. They're around. Still got
John Cena is heavily involved at the top of SmackDown.
Yeah. He still disappeared for about 2 months. So
that's because you couldn't see him.
Next segment.
All right. I got one. So this is something that's kind of bullying. I want to work this out with you guys. Like I mentioned, I got through the first 19 episodes of Lucha Underground. And I started to think about some things because Lucha Underground is one of those things.
But Sorg, before you do this, this is a disclaimer for everyone who communicates with Sorg. Do not spoil Lucha Underground for him.
You realize I've been listening to Midweek War with you guys, right?
I'm aware of that, but I know you forget things.
Okay,
I'm guessing.
By the way,
and plus,
by the
you
way,
are simultaneously ahead. And behind.
Okay, wait. Sorg, question. What color are Mil Muertes' pants right now? At when you're watching?
No,
it's good. Bobby, it's kind of a good indicator of the seasons. Yeah.
Yes.
Bobby, no joke.
That was
when we're.
Go ahead.
When we were watching and Mil Muertes debuted, Sorg was like, "Oh, look at those corduroy pants on Mil Muertes." And I'm like, "Sorg, if you want to get into an hour-long discussion about Mil Muertes' wardrobe, you talk to Bobby."
I was overjoyed.
Bobby? Tell me about his pants.
I just didn't like it. One of my favorite wrestling characters of all time, Mil Muertes.
Yeah.
Did not like his pants.
Or, as I've affectionately referred to him as, Bill Muertes.
Bill Muertes, yes.
Bill Muertes, the corduroy killer.
But are you up to after Grave Consequences?
I'm up through and including Grave Consequences.
And if you watch the episode afterwards.
No. Is that where he changes his pants?
Yes.
Yes! Because I watched beginning of season two, and he's all badass and dark and everything, right?
Minor spoilers here, Sorg. He comes back with the black pants.
I know he does!
His character.
I watched beginning of season two. I know this.
Sorg, this is why I
love, I love Chris is just sitting there observing this, by the way.
Like, I want no one to spoil anything about Lucha Underground for Sorg, because Sorg is reading the Harry Potter books out of order.
And later...
Sorg started with Cedric Diggory dying. Then he went back to find out...
Spoiler alert.
All right, I'm sorry. These books are old. Fucking read them, all right?
Okay.
You haven't read them. Dobby dies.
And,
fuck off.
And then I know the finish of the next book that hasn't been out yet.
Exactly! Well, Sorg has already read Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, and he knows what's happening in the movie. This is where we are at.
Guess what? They do hop on pop.
The worst spoilers. God damn it! The worst spoilers that I discovered. That's like not a so. Fair warning to you, Sorg. The worst spoilers that has no warning to it is if you look at the title histories of Lucha Underground titles. Because
I already told him. You cannot Wikipedia
everything that has been filmed is now on Wikipedia, including the next champions for the coming season. Mm-hmm. The entire season of title changes.
Wow.
And there's no warning at all.
You can't look anything up.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Look anything up.
I remember you telling me why not to, but I didn't realize that was the reason.
No,
I thought
the title changes are also in the title history right now. Because the match has technically happened, but
I can't even remember. I know who were the trios champions. Mm-hmm. I think I saw.
Well, don't say anything.
I think
remember, you are also ahead of us, Sorg.
Yeah.
See, this is what I'm saying. I don't want anyone to tell. Like, if you're going to talk to Sorg about Lucha Underground, the first question you ask is what episode are you on?
Yeah.
The second question: what color are Mil Muertes' pants?
Yes. That is also a valid question.
Sorg, you had a question in here at some point about...
Yeah. Yes, I'm sorry.
This is way more interesting than my question.
For everyone who could possibly talk to you during your Lucha excursion. Because we don't want anyone Edge returning at the Royal Rumbling this for you.
What? Edge returned at the Royal Rumble?
Yeah. Well, no. That's a veiled reference. Eamon spoiled the return of Edge for Lunchbox.
Yeah, Lunchbox was working that night. Or no, he had to leave his own pay-per-view party because he got called to work.
Yes.
Yeah, that was...
And Eamon texted him like, "Whoa, how about that finish with Edge winning, huh?" And he's like, "God damn it!"
Anyways, so I'm watching Lucha Underground, as we've been saying. And of course, we just got done with the Cruiserweight Classic and, NXT. And then, of course, the Cruiserweight's now on Raw and pay-per-views in front of 10, 15,000 people. So I started thinking, and I think when you look at the wrestling that happens on Lucha Underground, is very closely connected to what happens on, the NXT CWC properties, right? And I think the matches have been great on Raw and the pay-per-views so far. The four Cruiserweight matches that we've had with the holy crap, they're changing the ropes kind of thing. Getting past that. But there is just seems like something's a little different. And it could be just the fact that they're on Raw and they have different people. Maybe it could be the agents for all we know, right? But I wonder if you know, those are the kind of matches that classically we've seen on the indies, right? Your super indies, your even smaller shows like Ring of Honor, because as good as Ring of Honor is doing, Ring of Honor doesn't typically do more than 1,000, 1,500 people in a spot.
Yeah, that's accurate, yeah.
Right?
I don't know. I don't know what the house was from Stage AE. I mean, but Stage AE doesn't hold more than 800, 1,000, something right. like that.
I think the biggest crowd I've seen was when the first time I saw him in 2007 with Mad Mike at Hammerstein Ballroom. 2007, does that seem right? No.
Yeah, it was Danielson's last match, so whenever that was.
Hold on, I got the card here somewhere. Anyways, I'll find that later. But so I'm wondering if it's one of those where that style of wrestling translates best when, maybe on television at least, when it is in front of a crowd of 400 to 1,500 people, right? And maybe something's lost. And I started thinking a little bit about, like, when you're, like, I'm thinking about stage performances and the stuff I know from that, where there's performing to the back row, which is something I'm sure in wrestling that it's discussed mm-hmm. and taught as well. And, you know, think about a play in a giant place. You know, in a giant, I don't know, Heinz Hall, Benedum Center, Hammerstein Ballroom, something like that, versus a small playhouse play, right, where you're really close to things. It's more intimate environment. You know, we say we like the indie shows because it's you're more closer to the action and everything, right, versus being up in the nosebleeds for, say, a WWE event. So I think there is a little bit something to taking a cruiserweight match and playing to how many people were in Full Sail? Like, is it 400?
I think I'm not sure about.
I think I've heard.
Yeah, probably like
about 400.
Probably not much more than that.
Versus playing to 15,000, let's say, or even worse, WrestleMania 100,000, right? Which even we watch WrestleMania, and sometimes it's like that didn't feel the way it probably should have, right?
WrestleMania 20 to me felt way different than WrestleMania 29. I was at both those shows.
Right.
One was in the Garden. One was at the MetLife Arena.
Right.
Those felt like two completely different shows.
Right. And for space, right?
Yeah. Well, because, and I mean, if you listen to any wrestler podcast who talks about performing at an open-air arena at a WrestleMania, the first thing they say is, you can't hear the crowd.
Right. There's a disconnect.
You can't hear the crowd because all the sound
goes up. Sound goes up.
Yep. Yeah. So, I mean,
performing outside anyways, like, because even on small indie shows that are outside, just the sound goes in every direction and you can't hear. Whereas if you're in a smaller enclosed space,
it's bouncing towards you.
Yeah, it can sound like one of the things about Stage AE that was great was because it was a concert venue, that the sound just sounded so loud in there for some of those matches.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but I mean, if you go outside, even if you do go to like a festival or something and there's 300, 500, 600 people there, if it's just in a field, the sound just goes in every direction and you can barely hear them.
Right.
So,
right. So I feel like, so maybe that is part of it too. You know, maybe it is that disconnect of, you know, those same guys performing in front of, again, you know, to say 10,000 people at these arenas for Raw versus the 400 of Full Sail. And even, although I know it breaks down a little bit because I feel like we still get the feeling when we have NXT at the Barclays Center with as many people as at SummerSlam, right? But I don't know if it's because it's a concentrated fan base, so you still get the energy out of it. But it's definitely different. So I'm working around this idea, but I just kind of wanted to present to you and see what your guys' thoughts were. Mike?
I think it's also kind of like when you get like WWE shows in Europe, because they don't get that often. So you'll get the concentrated fan base.
As far as the NXT at the Barclays, you're saying?
Yeah. Yeah, because we get that once a year, maybe twice if we're lucky. And, you know, then when it's in the area. Plus, that because SummerSlam's already there, it's already a hub for wrestling. Like, I walked around the city earlier that day. I saw dozens of wrestling shirts just around the city, nowhere near the Barclays Center at all. Like, you could just tell there were a lot of people in the city that weekend for wrestling. Whether they were going to NXT or not, it was just they were in there for wrestling. But I also feel like the announcing has a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. Because if you watch Lucha Underground, Vampiro and Matt Stryker are into that show.
Mm-hmm.
If you watch the CWC, Mauro and Brian are sometimes a little too much, but they are into that show.
And oh my gosh!
Yeah, exactly. And if you watch Raw,
right.
Michael Cole is a non-reactionary robot.
He's and better because, than he's better oh, no,
no.
though.
Oh, no, 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 no. I'm not saying anything about what he's saying. I'm just saying the visual of it. They're not supposed to visually react to things.
Right.
They're like if Corey Graves pulled a Vampiro and started standing up and clapping at a high spot during a match, he'd have immediately someone barking his ear, "Shut the fuck down, Corey!" Like you're not allowed to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because they can't have that genuine, like the reason we love Jim Ross so much, genuine reactions.
Right.
Genuine reactions, because they weren't overly produced on the headsets back in the day. That's why Jim Ross has said numerous times he could not do what Michael Cole does, because he doesn't want someone in his ear all the time. He just wants to be able to call the match.
Right. Right.
I know we give Michael Cole a lot of shit, but it's like if I'm trying to talk about this and Sorg or Bobby is in my head saying, "Don't forget to mention the Twitter. Don't forget to mention the slice on Broadway." Like, you know, like, that's fucking difficult to do.
Right.
Like, right. And it takes away from your genuine reactions of the match because you're listening for what you have to do next. Like, I don't know. I think announcing has a lot to do with it, because you can tell Vampiro and Stryker are minimally produced, if at all, through their headsets.
Right. Bobby, Chris, what do you guys think?
Bobby, go ahead.
I don't know.
Thanks, Bobby.
Expert analysis by Bobby F. Jedtown.
I'll go. I don't know. Does the size of the venue matter? I don't know, because you mentioned the Barclays Center for TakeOver, and then there was the TakeOver in Texas before WrestleMania. And then there's, you know, Hammerstein Ballroom's not a small venue. It's a pretty, you can get a couple thousand people, and place gets rocking.
It depends on the room, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, I mean, if you're in the ballroom, if you're upstairs, you know, I think, 400, 500 tops.
And that's where, like, Raw started.
Yeah. The
And that's where TNA used to tape.
Yeah, but if you're down in the ballroom, that's a couple thousand, and that place can get rocking.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've seen some, I mean, just, you know, as a fan, I've seen some bigger crowds really, 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 really get into that faster paced style of wrestling. So I don't necessarily think it's 100% the venue. I think sometimes if you're at a Raw, or if you're at a Raw or a SmackDown, so much else is going on where they're worried about camera shots and you know, watching Raw live and watching Raw on TV might as well be two completely different experiences.
Although they're getting better. My cousin what do you say for weddings? He's a pastor, and he did my brother's wedding. Oh. We were talking.
He officiated,
I guess. Yes. Yeah. Refereed. I don't know.
Refereed the wedding.
He was talking about it. He brought his.
Hey, are we talking about Stephanie and Test again?
Hey. He was talking about how he went to Raw, and he brought the kids, and he was really worried about the kids. Like he's like, well, yeah, of course, we had a really great Raw. That's the one where Sasha won the belt and everything. And he's like, it was exciting, and Raw hasn't been that forever for the live crowd, right? It felt like a TV show. There was so much going on. But anyways, back to it. I'm sorry, further on your point.
Just that, you know, I think that you can have that same kind of energy, that same kind of intensity in venue of any size, just the right performers, the right, you know, if the magic's right and the mood's right, you can blow the lid off any arena.
Right.
In my opinion.
Exactly.
I just want to bring up a real quick point. I'm kind of echoing. The crowd has a lot to do with it too, because you'll have, like last week we were talking about the cruiserweights, how the crowd was silent at first, and then all of a sudden the crowd started catching on, started chanting, "This is awesome." By the end of the match, they were really into it. This week, on the other hand, the crowd was totally dead, and they were chanting CM Punk during the match.
Yeah.
And it was like...
That's another thing.
I don't know.
Well, see, the thing is, I think this goes back to what I say about a lot. TJ Perkins does have a character.
It kind of does.
Does he? Besides having a video game entrance, what is his character? Yeah, but that's not a character. There's no, it's the same problem WCW ran into.
And there are also people that the most people on Raw don't know who these people are. Like not only that you know that they're not really doing a lot of character things with them, because I think they're trying to stay pure with this, that it's a hey, go out there and have great matches, and that's really the part that matters, right? And I don't know. I don't know how that's working, and I think we'll see as people kind of get used to it, and the normals get introduced to the cruiserweights with this. I think it's going to take a little bit of time before people are like, "Oh no, this is the match that I don't need to go get popcorn for." Mm-hmm. So it's a building process. Yeah, some of that excitement will translate over from all of us that watch the entire cruiserweight thing, but also. Maybe that's not as strong as Enzo and Cass coming out from NXT and everybody, enough people in the crowd know it that it's infectious for the rest of the people, right?
But Sorg, the difference is Enzo and Cass do live promos. TJ Perkins, as far as WWE audiences know, he's a mute. He hasn't spoken once yet.
Well, yeah, yes. Yeah. There was a promo this week.
Not live.
In the back.
Yeah,
after
but
the Cruiserweight Classic, he did.
Yeah, but no, all right. We're assuming at least 2/3 of that Raw audience,
yeah, that's true,
did not watch the Cruiserweight Classic.
Of course. Mm-hmm. Right.
And like the first night they're introducing the Cruiserweights, you have Mick Foley talking about all of them.
Right.
None of them speaking for themselves.
Yeah.
And the champion doesn't even show up on live TV.
But you did see the promos for everybody, so you got their background.
Okay, but a promo package?
Mm-hmm.
Have you seen what people do during a promo package that airs on Raw? That's when they're checking their phones. That's
right.
When they're getting their food.
Right.
Unless it's Bray Wyatt so that they can put their fucking phones up, no one is listening to them. They need live in-ring promo time. Like, and Mick Foley stuttering through his opening promo for the Cruiserweights did not help the division, did not help any of the four guys in there.
Well, you know what helps? Like changing the ring ropes every match in the lighting. That tells me something important is going to happen. So, all right. Well, it'll be interesting. I think you're right. I think it is the dedication of the crowd, because it is such a variety of things. Not everybody's there for the Cruiserweights. Not everybody's there for everything else. It is too long of a show on Monday nights. It is a variety show. So maybe it would benefit if the Cruiserweights did get their own show, like more regularly or something too. So. Even if it was part of, it's the first hour of Raw, like, not everybody's there for it, you know? So.
Yeah.
I don't know. All right. So. Somebody messaged me. Hello. Oh, Mike, Bobby, I turned it down so I could kill your echo.
Sorry.
So I think I turned everybody down. Sorry about that, Bobby. So coming up, of course, I want to get into a little bit more talking about House of Hardcore here. Chris LeRusso, our wonderful esteemed guest this evening, is going to be a part of that. Mm-hmm. A lot going on there. And I think, I hear bits and pieces. Of course, when Tommy came through, hearing about what was going on with the shows that I think are mostly up in the kind of greater New York area,
it's
right?
It's starting to branch out.
Yeah,
he's
going on tour a bit more.
Yeah, I mean, Tommy obviously, I think, has kept close to his home base, but, it's starting to branch out more, starting to go on tour a lot more, and House of Hardcore is really starting to become a place where you can see some of the most interesting and best collections of talent. You see former WWE stars, you see former ECW stars, you see some of the hottest names on the independents right now, you see some TNA names in there, you see just all this mix of talent, some great women's wrestling, and it's really got that feel of, you know, some of those, you know, with Ring of Honor locking a lot of people into contracts, you know, House of Hardcore is sort of taking that super indie, pardon the pun, you know, vibe and really running with it. I mean, if you look at, you know, who's on this upcoming card, Sami Callihan, Tommy Dreamer, Rhino, so you're going to have somebody from the, you know, WWE, current WWE Tag Team Champion, you know, Team IWC versus Team LeBar, Jessica Havoc. I keep calling him Pepper Parks because I knew him for years as Pepper Parks. Forgive me if I've Candice LeRae, the return after a very brief banishment of Dylan Bostic. You know, Tony Nese. It's really a fantastic collection. Lucha Underground when M Dog 20, who looks a lot like that Son of Havoc guy. You know, just. Looks a lot like him.
I wonder if Matt Cross's mom's name is Linda.
Wait, that's a spoiler, isn't it?
Linda Havoc. So,
Linda Havoc. Sword, catch up on Lucha.
Would this be the time to show this clip?
I gave it to the guys because they're not going to see this while we're showing this. Is audio necessary for this?
It is not necessary for this. I've got to say, this has got to be the greatest 619 I have ever seen in my entire life. So when you watch this clip, please watch very closely Eric Young. So this is...
Describe for our audio listeners what we have going on.
So what
here.
We have right now is that Eric Young and EC3 have completely laid the ring out. The lights came out, and oh my God, it's Rey Mysterio. His first appearance since leaving the WWE at this point. And he has set both EC3 and Eric Young up for the 619. Watch Eric Young take the 619.
Oh, jeez. Straight out of
Oh, the- my God!
That is SummerSlam 2005.
There is no reason he should be alive, okay? I have never seen anyone take the 619 like that.
He does a flip. He does a bump, roll into standing, and then backs over the top rope on the other side of the ring.
And lands on his head on the apron, leaving the ring.
Oh, no.
What of the, like, I when the first time I saw that, I actually didn't see the actual footage. I saw a fan with their cell phone camera, and it was like, Eric Young is dead. Eric Young has died. There's like he's not getting up, and we replayed it a bunch of times. It's like he's dead. There's no way. Like I just love this.
Isn't he already bleeding from the match too, or something?
Yes, he is bleeding. It was there's a barbed wire board. There's a barbed wire board in the corner.
Jeez. So I mean, it is still very ECW what they're doing here. Yeah. A little bit.
Bang.
Bam. Bam. And whoop.
Goodbye.
I watched the head spot this time.
Head first out of the ring.
Oh, no. Oh, not nearly as scary as Cesaro this past weekend, but I'll watch it again.
It was up there.
I find that point.
What of the...
Boink. Oh, no.
But, I mean, and this is what you see at House of Hardcore. Like where were you going to see Eric Young and Rey Mysterio and, you know,
right.
Son of Havoc and all these people together? It's like... And that's what you know, like it's what you really get at House of Hardcore. And the other thing is, you get is, you know, a lot of your some of your IWC favorites. Myself, Team IWC, which is Jimmy Vegas, Andrew Palace, and
who is that again?
Andrew Palace,
who will be on that couch next week?
I should set a landmine here or something.
Don't tell him that.
Yeah. I'm still a little sore from digging a staple out of my head. So,
I haven't seen a stapler.
Well,
in a WWE ring, IWC ring.
No,
not the WWE ring either. Until Cage Fury.
Yeah,
that was a surprise.
That was I certainly ended up surprised.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah, hey, Cage Fury, you gotta. Got to bring something different. So
apparently, wow.
But again, where was it? House of Hardcore. So you've got, you know, Jimmy Vegas, John McChesney, Andrew Palace, LeBar, which we will see Wardlow, RJ City, Dylan Bostic, you know, Hardcore Holly and EC3. I'm actually really looking forward to that one.
It's going to be amazing. I haven't seen, like, I know Hardcore Holly was just up at AIW a few months ago. So I haven't seen, like, what he's been doing lately. He sounds like he's having a good time when he popped up on Cole Cabana's podcast a few episodes ago on one of the live things. I'm looking forward to see, like, what's going on with Hardcore Holly these days. Because when was he in WWE last, right? A bit ago.
WWE had ECW on Sci-Fi.
Oh, wow. Yeah, and he took that really horrible table slice to RVD. The back and everything. Table bump. Wow.
Yeah, there was, but I mean, you know, in addition, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, will we see Space Cat?
What?
Sami Callihan.
We will see Sami Callihan. I cannot confirm or deny the appearance of Space Cat.
I don't know about Space Cat.
So,
I still need to get to a House of Hardcore show because their home base is in Poughkeepsie.
Yes.
Like, I've never been to a show because I've always been working or doing, like, a wedding or something. I had a wedding during one of the House of Hardcore shows. And I'm like, well, I can't blow that off.
But who ref that wedding? 30-minute time limit.
I mean, they're. I know they're in the New York area, but I know they're doing the ECW Arena, which I think it's a 2300 now, right? Doing the old ECW Arena. You know, working with IWC here. So.
Oh, hey, it's not. Don't. I'm going to give you a tip right now, especially if you're on a public computer. Don't go to houseofhardcore.com.
It's houseofhardcore.net.
Net.
No clean finishes there.
No clean finishes there. Wow. Which directs you to orgasm.com. Free plug for those guys.
Although you can watch Sunny at House of
Hey.
I'm really glad I didn't instinctively switch that shot because wow.
Yeah.
Tickets
are available at houseofhardcore.net.
Yes. Not .com. Good stuff coming up. And of course, other shows are coming up. If you're in other areas, they're going to be in. Where is this one? Where's 19?
That's, I believe that's Cleveland.
The Cleveland's the night before, and then they're going to be. But yeah, they don't have like the states on.
No, they do. Things. You have to scroll
Wisconsin.
Down.
Wisconsin. Yeah. Wisconsin's going to get it, Mike. Come on. And, of course, the ECW Arena on December 16th and the 17th. No, that's a different one. That is actually going to be somewhere else. A lot of great stuff going on with them. And they're really building up. I mean, it really is. Tommy Dreamer is a guy that knows what he's doing as far as booking. I mean, how many years did he work with, you know, WWE in this kind of capacity, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell this is the calling in the favors with my buddies shows, too, a little bit.
I mean, I think it's also getting some attention to people people want to be on these shows. Like they're really, really, like I said, great collection of talent that, you know, bringing together talent you didn't think you'd be able to see in this day and age.
Are we in a really interesting spot where we do have this? I partially was starting to bring up with Drew Gulak being on Raw, but he is a WWN contracted wrestler.
Mm-hmm.
We'll be meeting Evolve and everything like that. So like this thing where we have people on Raw in not jobber positions that are not WWE signees, you know, and the kind of people popping up in NXT and still basically doing like that Rhino's still doing indies and he's the SmackDown tag champion or even Johnny Gargano doing all the things that he's done since really being signed with WWE. As an NXT wrestler, you know, they're allowed to finish these off. There's like this interesting kind of halfway point where a WWE being on WWE TV doesn't mean being a WWE wrestler anymore. But, you know, and then you have something like this where it's like, well, here's some people from a Ring of Honor, TNA, NXT, you know, all in one
Lucha
place.
Underground,
all in one place. You know, I mean, well, hell, Lucha Underground is just kind of a seasonal thing for a lot of these guys too. It's not something that tours or anything like that. Ring of Honor only has so many things, although Ring of Honor is getting a lot more.
Ring of Honor is actually in an interesting spot now where they've had that, they've built a relationship not only with New Japan, but with CMLL.
Right.
And there's now the three companies that have agreed to work together, and you saw Ring of Honor's now got a trios title that they'll be starting up here at All-Star Extravaganza. So that's another thing where you see talent from New Japan, CMLL, and you might get to see them in a Ring of Honor ring in the coming year. So
after Pittsburgh, of course, I talked about it a little bit last week. Kevin Kelly was on the Taz Show. I happened to find it in my feed, popped up the Taz Show's Facebook Live feed of us. Mm-hmm. And he was talking about how Ring of Honor is at this point where, you know, there's some people that obviously will, you know, are using this as a stepping stone to get to WWE or whatever. But they're able to provide, you know, between all those relationships, a great schedule for these guys that they can make a living off of this and not really have to go anywhere else. But
Young Bucks told me that their schedule after Pittsburgh was absolutely insane because it was not only finishing up the Ring of Honor dates,
right,
then it's to Japan for this tour that they just wrapped up. I think it was 3 days in Japan. Then back for the pay-per-view at the end of the month. Then the England shows in November. So it's just going to be, you know, this insane schedule all the way up until, I think, Thanksgiving for them, where they're going to be all over the world.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. And not have to deal with being part of a giant corporate machine, you know? So that's not for everybody. Some people, you know, are great with the job at the giant monolithic bank. Some of us are just...
Some of us want to be in the Wild West.
Some of us just are okay being freelancers, right? Mm-hmm. And looking to get... You know, and that's in wrestling, that's in work, that's in everywhere, right? So it's very interesting. Very interesting time to be a wrestler. Very interesting time to be a wrestling fan. Right?
Absolutely.
A lot of opportunities.
Could end up wrestling in a state park.
But he'll be not in a state park, but the Court Time Sports Center here in Elizabeth, PA, in the outside of Pittsburgh October
15th.
So go check that out. All right, so it's time to find out what you guys learned from wrestling this week. Who wants to go first? Anybody?
Don't everyone rush at once.
All at once.
I'll tell you what I learned. Please, go ahead.
Okay. I learned that WWE needs to stop making text adventure games for Randy Orton.
That was weird. It was interesting. Wish I caught all of it.
I question whether it was interesting. It was... If you're gonna do stuff like that, don't have the most obvious ending be the ending. Because, like... I don't know. Like, Randy Orton, Bray Wyatt...
It wasn't going to be the final deletion.
Everything in WWE wants to be the final deletion. And guess what? Even if they brought in Matt Hardy, they wouldn't let him do the final deletion. But see, here's the problem and the underlying thing. The final deletion was fun. Decay vs. Delete was fun. Guess what? You can't do stuff like that, translate it from a completely filmed and packaged product to a live event. Because if Bound for Glory happens, I'm expecting Vanguard 1 to come in and start shooting fireworks all over the place. Guess what's not going to fucking happen? That.
Now, you know, no. They did catch Universal Studios on fire one time on pay-per-view before. So,
yes, but that was entirely
Is that going to be the end of TNA, that just Vanguard 1 comes in and just fires a missile right into...
Oh, wouldn't that be great?
Okay. If the end of TNA is Vanguard 1 becoming sentient, and that's how Skynet is formed, I am all in.
It needs to be something like that time that Chikara, like, ended a pay-per-view by, like, ending in the middle of a match and kicking everybody out of the building.
Oh, yeah, security came in and tore the set down and all that stuff.
Yeah, like, all that kind of stuff. Like Impact should just completely do that. Mm-hmm. I think that's okay. I think that's within the realm, right? Yeah, certainly.
But, like, Vanguard 1 isn't going to show up in that match if they have Bound for Glory.
Are you sure? Like, are you
positive,
sure?
Sword?
Because Vanguard...
Do you want to know how I know? Because those things, when they're filmed, guess who's controlling Vanguard 1?
Jeremy Borash.
It's either Matt or Jeff.
No. Jeremy Borash admitted that he was going to be hiding somewhere at a high-profile wrestling show as Vanguard 1 accompanied Matt Hardy to the ring.
Okay, yeah, that ain't gonna be Bound for Glory. That'll probably be House of Hardcore.
That'd be pretty cool.
Yeah, it'd be pretty awesome, actually. Yeah. So, well, I don't know what the droning rules are at Universal Studios, but actually, we do know, because that's why they did it where they did, because they said we can't use the drone at Universal Studios because they don't want it. They're worried about it falling and hitting a patron. Patron, yeah. And that's a liability. So there actually is a no fly zone at Universal Studios, so they went to Matt and Jeff's backyard and blew stuff up. So thank you, Universal Studios, for making that happen.
But that's the thing. Stuff like the Final Deletion and stuff like that doesn't translate to the ring.
No,
that's why most of Lucha Underground stuff is backstage.
Mm-hmm.
Like the story is backstage. When you were at the tapings, you can tell us the matches that happened. But apart from telling us who the champions were at the time, you have no fucking idea what the stories are.
Nope.
What color were his pants?
What? Bobby wants to know what color Mil Muerte's pants
were. Or the color of Mil Muerte's pants. That's the real story here. Bobby, or I'm sorry, Chris, you had something.
Let's see. What I learned in wrestling this week. I learned that... from week to week, you just got to be happy with what this crazy business gives you. If you've got a week where you're on Ring of Honor and IWC with Corey and Alex Daniels and Wrestling Ophidian and Turner Hall and all this stuff, the very next week you could be wrestling an outdoor show and seeing just how sunburned Bulk Nasty can get within 3 hours. And Bulk Nasty can get very sunburned in 3 hours.
Wow.
I mean, like fluorescent red sunburned. In 3 hours. So.
He's having a bad week.
Bulk?
Yeah.
Well.
Recover from that. Jeez. Bobby, what'd you learn?
I learned, thanks to the WWE Network, that Scott Norton ate over 200 pancakes, beating a world record, thus being renamed Flapjack Norton as part of the tag team, the Lumberjacks. This was a part of a network segment that I can't remember the name, but it was like the eloquent meanderings of gladiators. It was crazy.
This is a French art film? What are you talking about?
It was on WWE Network.
It was a promo. It was a Where Are They Now segment.
Oh, okay.
No, it wasn't a Where Are They Now segment.
Is it the promo segment they do? The eloquent something.
A promo segment.
Yeah, it's an interstitial where... they play in between shows sometimes. Bobby, you're glitching again. I want to take over this. No, this is why I love watching the stream on WWE Network, because they'll have this random stuff that you never catch, right? Like that, or like just like. Random Macho Man promos, and there's actually an intro for like Macho Madness and stuff for it, right? But it's like it's some super long, like the eloquent speaking engagements of gladiators, or you're like something like that, like he was saying.
It was longer than that.
Yeah, like some obscenely long thing, and it'll just be the most ridiculous thing you've ever heard. That, you know, it'll be something random like that, you know, from. Superstars or you know, Florida Championship Wrestling or whatever the heck it is, right? Yeah, it's pretty tremendous. That's why when I look and it's like 10 till, I know I want to definitely turn on the live stream of WWE Network, because something has probably ended by now and they can play something like that. So I learned that J-Rock has good aim.
Not even gonna ask.
I have video to prove it. I happened to be shooting at the time.
Houseofhardcore.com.
Not dot com.
No.
.net.
RWA show. He tosses his shirt directly at the announcers.
Give it up one time.
Give it up one time for him.
Houseofhardcore.net.
So shouts to J-Rock for that.
Whitehouse.com.
Is that still a thing? Didn't they fix that? Didn't they buy it?
They better have fixed it.
Hopefully. So on that note, thank you so much, everybody. Thank you, everybody, listening. Everybody live. Wheels, Tragar, everybody else has popped in and throughout the evening. I swear we'll get a better chat sooner or later here. Of course, Mad Mike at Mad Mike 4883 on the Twitters.
That's me, Sorg. And Sorg, I don't. I have to talk to Eamon. The midweek war might be a little delayed this week because I, as a Toys R Us employee, have Force Friday, so I'll be working at midnight. Commercialism. Commercialism.
Was Rogue One Toys coming in?
Rogue One Toys are coming in.
Oh yeah! Spoiler alerts abound. Bobby F. J. Town is Bobby F. J. Town.
At Bobby F. J. Town on Twitter. New boss battle coming tomorrow or Thursday.
Tomorrow-ish. And, of course, the great Chris LeRusso, the heir apparent. I haven't used your moniker all night, I realized.
That's all right. At Chris LeRusso on Twitter, Chris LeRusso on Facebook. IWC, Ring of Honor, Black Diamond Wrestling, Mega Championship Wrestling, NWA Midwest. Here you can make sure you check out IWC presents House of Hardcore October 15th at the Court Time Sports Center. You can also catch me later this month, October 22nd at Mega Championship Wrestling. And I will be making an appearance October 29th at the Monster Factory, November 5th, IWC in Clearfield. And beyond that, just keep an eye on Twitter, Facebook, all those places. And see where you can, when Chris LeRusso is coming to a wrestling show near you.
Check it out. And thank you, everybody. Again, check out everything at live.sorgatron. Live.wrestlingmayhemshow.com.
We were so close.
Every Tuesdays at 10 p.m. Eastern time as we regale you with stories. And make our guests tell you their road stories, too. That's a thing. And 412-206-WMS0, the email address.
Good times.
Good times at WrestlingMayhemShow.com. Subscribe to us on all the podcast things, including, of course, iHeartRadio and the Facebook and the Wrestling Mayhem Show YouTube page. Live streams, Facebook Lives, all kinds of things. Follow us on Patreon. Patreon to Patreons. Share it. Share the mayhem with friends. We'll see you guys next time. Mayhem out. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at sorgatronmedia.com. You guys are cool.